Welcome to another episode of Redeeming Truth. This one will not be controversial at all. The question is, why do we here at our church and in our convictions not sing or direct people to Bethel music, Jesus culture, Hillsong, Elevation Worship with Stephen Furtick, and all those like-minded movements? While we are grateful for the zeal and the passion of some of these ministries, the well-intentioned, seemingly well-intentioned drive to reach people and to reach a culture and to reach a generation, you guys can speak to this. Passion, while it's essential, we want to be passionate. Goodness, you got to be passionate about the truth and about something in life, or you'll just kind of live this mundane existence. Mm. Passion can be essential, but it's not always reliable. Mm. Speak to that for a quick minute as we start here.
Yeah, I mean, what's the most important thing about the gospel? That we get it right, right? Truth is the most important thing. If we're worshiping the wrong Jesus, we're outside of the grace of God. So we have to be focused on truth. And if we're passionate, we have to be passionate about the truth. And I would take anyone who asked this question to Ephesians 5. In Ephesians 5, verse 15 and following, it gives us a way to live life. It says, look carefully how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of your time. And go down to a few verses later, it says, be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, making melody to the Lord with your heart. So Christians are commanded to sing. Not only that, we're commanded to address each other and, in fact, teach each other through music. So if our music is being used as a vehicle to teach false doctrine, or even doctrine that looks true but is not quite there, then we should reject it wholeheartedly. Because if we're filled with the Spirit singing songs, we will be filled with songs that sing truth.
Okay, so clearly we've played our cards. The position would be that these movements are false, teaching false doctrines, that music matters, lyrics matter. So let me quickly quote things and make sure that we're being fair and accurate. Mm-hmm. And then Dale, I want you to chime in certainly based on this. So what Bethel teaches, and Bill Johnson being one of the heads of this movement and what is typically coined now the New Apostolic Reformation, what Todd White teaches and believes, what is spread throughout these areas, conferences and places like the Send and others, they are teaching, based on Philippians 2, 5 through 7, that Jesus was just a man in right relationship to God. He was not God when he did his miracles, his signs, his wonders. He was just a man living like we could now today. And so, based on that, we can do them too. And we're supposed to be living this supernatural lifestyle that not supernatural as in leading people to Christ, the miracle of salvation, or even just praying for people and seeing God move in remarkable ways. But actually, supernatural meaning we're prophets, we're apostles, we are healers, we're miracle workers, and going around and doing the like. And so you know we're being fair, I want to quote Bill Johnson from page 29 of his book, When Heaven Invades Earth, where he says, Jesus did his miracles, his signs, wonders, as a man in right relationship to God. And then there's an ellipsis. Not as God. Later on in the book, When Heaven Invades Earth, on page 79, he says these exact words, he laid his divinity aside. That is Christological heresy. To use the H word in the realist, literal sense, that is Christological heresy. You cannot, based on not only the teaching of Scripture, but the Council of Chalcedon, the early church, all the way through the ages, even to now, say that Jesus just at any point, you know, wasn't God. He laid aside his divinity. They base it on Philippians 2. They say that the kenosis, or the emptying of Christ, was an emptying of his divinity, his divine nature, and that he laid that aside as a model to just show us how we could do it too. I am with R.C. Sproul when he says Jesus was truly man and truly God. And other scholars who have said that it was a subtraction by addition. In other words, it was a humbling or an emptying because he added humanity. To who he already was, which is basically like God coming down and was saying, I'm going to add puny human to my repertoire. I'm going to become
the struggle,
one of them.
The weakness.
That's right. It was not a doctrinal position that licensed us to just be mere men now going and doing signs and wonders. So here's what my conviction would be, and I believe we share this conviction, that if you're going to demean Christ and his divinity, you're going to say that he wasn't actually divine, that now we have a false Jesus. a false Jesus can't save. And people say, well, hold on, you don't know their heart. You can't judge their heart. What if they're well-intentioned? You know what? Mormons are well-intentioned. Mm-hmm. You know that in Islam, there's a Jesus. Mm-hmm. In many other false religions, there is a place for Jesus. Yeah. So if we're getting Jesus wrong, that Jesus can't save. And so I don't want to sing about that Jesus. I don't want to talk about that Jesus. And I sure don't want to point people to that Jesus. Yeah. And so, Dale, you know, speak to this. Would you say this is the definition of and fits under the category of false teaching in the New Testament?
Well, it's absolutely false teaching. And, you know, one of the things that a lot of the pushback we get from people against what we believe on this is that we're judging motives. Mm. And the reality is that we don't need to judge motive. What we're doing is we're judging doctrine. We're judging what it is that they're teaching. And there's a reality that a lot of this music is good music.
Yeah.
It's produced really well. Mm. It sounds great.
Sounds great.
It's got a hook. I mean, yep. it's stuff that makes people feel good.
Yep. And some of it is even doctrinally fairly sound just keep it in isolation.
And we talked about one song before where one of your favorite songs, just to put you on blast.
Right,
and
sure.
I'm with you, the yeah. No Longer Slaves.
Love,
right?
When that song first came out, before I kind of got into this issue, mm-hmm. I loved that song.
Yep.
Absolutely.
So it's not like the movement has just blatant heresy and they're just spewing false doctrine in every song and now, you know, you couldn't sing any of it or you're going to hell. It's not what we're saying. You would say this is convictional. And also, you know, the old cliche, even a broken clock is right twice
That's
a day.
Right. That's right.
Or, you know, the devil ain't coming to deceive people with all lies. Doesn't he use some truth?
So as you guys already talked, this comes down to Christology. Mm-hmm. This comes down to what Jesus are you singing about, mm-hmm. right? And when you use like terms, like LDS, they use the name of Christ. And it seems like they're talking about the same Jesus mm-hmm. much of the time until you lift the hood up
yeah.
on their theology and mm-hmm. what they truly believe. And this is a very similar situation with NAR. You have to lift the hood up. What do they believe? And mm-hmm. when you listen to them in their own words, we're not putting words in anybody's mouth.
Nope. Mm-hmm.
In their own words, they are teaching and believing in a different Jesus other than the Bible. Mm-hmm. That's not in the Bible, I should say.
Yep.
So when they're producing music that seemingly is using the same terms that an Orthodox yeah. church like ours would use, mm-hmm. There's a comfort level to it. There's a hook to it, like, oh, yeah. they're singing about my Lord,
yep.
until you find out that they're not.
It's really yeah. good. So, I want to add one clarity point here as well is, you know, people will naturally say, and I agree with asking this question, well, then why in the world do you guys sing It Is Well With My Soul by Horatio Spafford,
sure.
who didn't have any doctrine of hell or other things? There were some serious problems. And then people kind of get snarky and say, well, you know, there were problems with C.S. Lewis. There were problems with this guy and this guy. You know, well, I guess they're all heretics. We better just listen to you guys. You know, you got the lock on sound doctrine. Well, mm-hmm. listen, the reason that we aren't going to point people to this music or sing this music is because these are actively heretical movements.
Mm-hmm.
You know, singing It Is Well, true lyrics, great song. Singing It Is Well With My Soul is not sending somebody to Bethel Supernatural School of Ministry
right.
or Todd White's Lifestyle Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to lead people astray. And we have real stories from people, parents at our church, parents from other churches, parents of college students who come crying because their students have been swept up. We've mm-hmm. seen a lot of people saved out of these movements. But one of the things, too, we would say is we're not commanding this of other churches or other people. Mm-hmm. These are our convictions, and our convictions do not have to be your commands. However, we should all fairly understand and clearly understand why people have the positions that they do. And so mm-hmm. we want to continue to make clear that we are not going to sing active heretics and yeah. point people to active heresy where they're going to think, you know, you're muddying the water here.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to pay royalties to these people as well with CCLI and some of the legal proceedings now. And so we don't want to pay money to heresy.
That's right.
We don't want to partner with it in any way, shape, or form. That's our conviction.
Can I give one other example?
Please do, absolutely.
So for churches who would say, you know what, we'll just sing this one Bethel song or these two Hillsong tunes that are really good and they sing the truth and they do give truth to our people, that would be tantamount to us saying, if Bill Johnson would come and preach a biblical exegetical sermon
yes.
in our church, then we'll let him come fill the pulpit just for that one time.
That's a great
Practically,
point.
Pragmatically, that's the exact same thing. We
yep.
would never do that. And
that's
we,
right.
as a community, we would be ripped to shreds for doing that. And everybody would say, why in the world would you do that? Well, the exact same thing is happening with music every That's Sunday right. in many churches around the country yeah. when heresy is creeping in one step at a time through the music. Because pragmatically, like we've talked about before, it's beautiful, it gets people in the door, and it's popular.
I mean, this is such an important issue. Jesus talked about it in his first sermon, right? Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. Matthew chapter 7, Jesus says very plainly, beware.
Yes. Yeah.
Beware of false prophets who mm-hmm. come to you in sheep's clothing. Mm. So they might look like you,
yeah.
but beware, because yeah. they're bringing a different message. And yes. that message is not my message.
Yeah.
So if our Lord said beware,
yeah.
all we're doing is saying, listen to what Jesus is saying. Yeah, beware. Right. Do your homework.
Yeah.
Learn about this. Don't just take our word for it.
That's right.
Do your own work on it yeah. and figure this out.
Amen. And I mean, I'm not being snarky or sarcastic when I say this. Growing up in the circle that I did, and now being as old as I am and just having experience with some of this, I always want to ask people, you know, why are you so excited and so deeply convicted to sing Bethel and to sing Jesus culture and to reach this generation? But 20 years ago, and for the last 20 years, you refused to buy my uncle's instrumental CD. You're not playing the Benny Hinn worship CD in your churches. I've had like conservative guys that are even more right, you know, over the right side of things, and I mean really deeply, you know, convicted guys over things, have told me before, I've heard your Uncle Benny preach better gospel presentations mm-hmm. than Baptist preachers. Mm-hmm. So it's really not about the fact that these people don't offer anything or that there's nothing truthful in it.
Yeah.
The real question is, you know, what are we going for? Are we caving to the culture? Am I letting the radio DJ and the top, you know, Billboard hits dictate what I sing? Mm-hmm. Am I letting my methodological leanings dictate now my theological mm-hmm. convictions? Then sing them all. Welcome them all in. Open the doors for everyone and live with the conviction all the way. Take it to its logical yeah. conclusion. Mm-hmm. And so I don't say that to be snarky mm-hmm. or sarcastic. It's just always been interesting to me that the minute it got cool,
yeah.
the minute it had V-necks and skinny jeans and leather jackets, and it made it into the mainstream, was the minute a whole bunch of churches decided, you know what, this is what people like. Kyle, you mentioned pragmatism. Mm-hmm. You know what, let's do it. This will grow it. This will build it. And all those other guys are just stuck up, you know, theology mm-hmm. nerds.
Yeah.
Any last thoughts on this?
I mean, we could talk for hours. Yeah, we could. So maybe in future episodes.
Okay. Well, if you're a church leader and you're listening to this and you want to know more, we wrote a book called Defining Deception. There's other great books out there. If you want something shorter and cheaper, no obligation to buy the book, go look at some blogs online, go check some things out, and do the research. Be a Berean, be a good steward of what God has asked you to do and asked you to lead. Protect his flock. And the last thing I'll say, if you're a church member or a church leader and you start to stir with conviction on this, I know how I would want to be treated and how we would want to be treated. Please don't barrel into your pastor's office.
That's right.
And yell at them and say, you know, right. you're a heretic. And we no. give them an opportunity. Be gracious. Be submissive. Be kind. Do the research. Don't go cage stage on everybody. But know that Christ is worth it. And let's get Jesus right. And let's serve him faithfully. We'll be back with more episodes of Redeeming Truth. Until then, we'll see you soon.